Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Last Hours of Jesus, From Gethsemane to Golgotha, by Ralph Gorman. Narrated by Tom Parks. Preface. I have not written this book for scripture scholars who have the same access as I have to sources of information on the Passion of Jesus Christ. I have directed it to non-specialists who would like a fuller treatment of the Passion than is found in the great lives of Christ, such as those by Lagrange, Pratt, Le Breton, Filion, and Ricciotti. I have used their works, of course, as well as the best commentaries on the Gospels and various treatises on aspects of the Passion in English, Latin, French, German, and Italian. It has been my effort to tell the story of the last hours of Jesus accurately and in a manner interesting and intelligible to the ordinary listener. The description of some scenes may appear fictionized, but is based on information concerning the period, places, and persons involved. The four Gospels are the main source for the history of the Passion. New Testament quotations are from the Confraternity edition and are used with the permission of the Confraternity of Christian Doctrine. Background information is provided by the Mishnah and by early historians. For archaeological data, I have used freely the lectures and writings of Père Vincent, greatest of all Palestinian archaeologists and my former professor at the École Biblique in Jerusalem, where it was my privilege to do postgraduate studies for 3 years. I wish to express my gratitude to my friends and fellow religious, Fathers Richard Kugelman, C.P., Hilary Sweeney, C.P., and Barnabas Ahern, C.P., for valuable and constructive criticism. Special thanks are due Miss Claire Foy, editorial assistant of The Sign, for typing the manuscript and for many helpful suggestions. Prologue. Chapter 1. The Background. The story of Jesus' last hours properly begins at the Garden of Gethsemane. Here begins his Passion, in that frightful agony wherein the God-man almost seemed to have been rejected by his Father, even as he was neglected by his sleeping apostles. And here, too, strengthened at the end of his agony, Jesus confronts his enemies, the antagonists in the tragic yet soaring drama of his suffering and death, the religious leaders of his chosen people, and Judas Iscariot, one of his chosen 12, who had betrayed him for a price. How could such a thing come to pass? How could anyone harm a man who traveled around the country with a few poor disciples, teaching about the kingdom of God, working wonders in healing the sick, proclaiming a doctrine of love of God and neighbor? How could such a man be betrayed by one of his closest followers, arrested like a thief in the night, condemned by the highest court of the Jews, condemned again and sentenced to death on the cross by the highest Roman authority? That mystery needs some explanation. To understand how such a thing could happen, it is necessary to know something of the ideas and institutions of the Jews at the time of Christ, and especially to understand two Jewish sects, the Sadducees and the Pharisees. It is also necessary, against this background, to probe the psychology of Judas, that enigma of perfidy. The military threat from their neighbors was not the only menace to the Jews during several centuries before the birth of Christ. Pagan Greek culture and philosophy threatened to destroy the monotheistic religion of the chosen people. Hellenizing influences pressed in upon them from all sides. The Sadducees and Pharisees owed their origins in large measure to the varied reaction to this threat. The Pharisees reacted strongly against the pagan influences and clung tenaciously to the Mosaic Law. As the name itself indicates in Aramaic, the language of Palestine at that time, the Pharisees were separatists. This may have been a nickname given them by others. They called themselves Haberim, comrades, or the pious. They were called separatists because they kept themselves apart from anything that might render them legally impure. Even the people of the land, who were impure because they found it impossible to observe all the legal purifications practiced by the Pharisees. The Pharisees were probably the descendants of the Assideans, mentioned at the time of the Maccabees. They were a religious rather than a political party, and their religion was strongly nationalistic. We have little information on their organization, but it is likely that candidates passed through a period of trial before becoming full-fledged members. At the very heart of the party were the scribes, although it is a mistake to identify scribes and Pharisees. There were scribes who were Sadducees. For the most part, however, the scribes were Pharisees, trained in the knowledge of the law and its application. In fact, the most important characteristic of the Pharisees was their claim to know the law better than anyone else, their rigor in practicing it, and their determination to impose it on others. They emphasized 3 points of the law in particular: observance of the Sabbath, legal purifications, and the payment of tithes to Levites and priests. By the time of Christ, the Pharisaical scribes had developed an extremely complex and detailed oral law that, theoretically, expounded and applied the Torah. This mass of legal tradition was declared to be as binding as the Torah itself. Finally, a point was reached where it was considered more blameworthy to teach contrary to the precepts of the scribes than contrary to the law of Moses. The observance of the dictates of the scribes became an end in itself, to which all other moral and religious considerations were secondary. Toward the close of the second century after Christ, the rabbis began to consign the teaching of the scribes to writing, in works that developed into the Jerusalem and Babylonian Talmuds. A cursory reading of the Talmuds reveals the casuistic hair-splitting of the scribes, as well as the complicated mesh of man-made traditions and observances in which they entangled their followers. Nevertheless, it was the knowledge and observance of these legal minutiae that constituted the perfection to which the Pharisees aspired. It must be conceded in favor of the Pharisees that, in spite of their legalistic excesses, they represented Orthodox Judaism and did much to save the Jews from pagan Greek influences. They professed belief in divine providence and free will, the resurrection and final retribution, and the existence of angels and spirits. Like the Pharisees, the Sadducees appeared first in the 2nd century BC. They probably took their name from Zadok, high priest at the time of David and Solomon. At first, they were devoted, orthodox religious leaders recruited chiefly from the priestly families. Over the years, they became increasingly tolerant of Hellenizing influences and proportionately less devoted to their own religion. By the time of Christ, religious leadership had passed to the Pharisees, especially to the scribes who were doctors of the law. This was so true that the Sadducees found it prudent, at least in public, to show deference for the teachings of the scribes and to conform to their legal prescriptions. Most of the priests were Sadducees, although there is occasional mention of priests who were Pharisees. The Sadducean priests performed the rituals and sacrificial functions reserved exclusively to the priesthood, but otherwise, the religious life of the people took its form and direction from the Pharisees. An outstanding characteristic of the Sadducees was their complete rejection of the oral traditions of the Pharisees. Infected by Greek skepticism, many of them denied the providence of God, the existence of spirits, the immortality of the soul, the resurrection, and future retribution. This world and this life were enough for them, and their efforts were directed to providing a cushion of riches and honors against possible adversity. Their influence was derived from their priestly rank, their wealth, and their political power under the Romans. The people to whom Christ addressed himself in his public ministry looked to the Sadducees as high-ranking priests who represented them before God in the temple, and as the political leaders who administered civil and criminal law under the general direction of the Romans. They looked to the scribes and the Pharisees for the teaching and example that would indicate what they were to believe and the way in which they were to walk. From what we know of the Sadducees on the one hand and the scribes and the Pharisees on the other, it was almost a foregone conclusion that, in spite of their differences, they would close their ranks against Christ in a concerted effort to maintain their control over the people. Another important religious group of the period were the Essenes, but we are not concerned with them here, as there is no record that they were directly involved in Christ's life and passion. They are mentioned in contemporary writings, but not in the pages of the Old or New Testament. They were a semi-monastic organization living near the Dead Sea and rightly identified, we think, with the brotherhood revealed in the writings known as the Dead Sea Scrolls. It is highly probable that there were some contacts between this brotherhood and some of Jesus' first followers. St. John the Baptist lived in the same neighborhood near the Dead Sea, and some of his followers, such as Andrew, John, and Peter, became the first disciples of Jesus. The language of the Gospel of St. John shows certain resemblances to the Dead Sea Scrolls. The Jewish rejection of Christ is difficult to understand without some knowledge of popular conceptions of the Messiah current at the time. The people formed their ideas on this subject from the teachings of the scribes and the Pharisees, rather than from the Sadducees, whose agnostic outlook on life and religion left no room for messianic hopes. Fortunately, many writings have come down to us from this epoch in Jewish history, and scholars can describe with considerable accuracy the Jewish attitude toward the hoped-for Messiah. In 63 BC, Pompey, the Roman general, had taken Jerusalem. The Jews had become vassals of the Romans, and Palestine a mere outpost on the eastern fringe of the vast empire. This state of affairs naturally revived Jewish preoccupation with the messianic promises, and renewed hopes for a great deliverer to come. When Christ appeared on the banks of the Jordan to be baptized by John, and then went north into Galilee to begin his public ministry, a ferment of messianic agitation stirred the people, a feeling that Israel was at the threshold of a new era that would soon dawn. It is strange that in the popular imagination as it pictured the messianic times, the Messiah himself had assumed a secondary place, while the restoration of the nation became the event on which all hope centered. The distinguishing marks of the hoped-for period were the deliverance of Israel from its conquerors, the return of the Jews from exile abroad, and the dominion of God over the world, a dominion that was to be exercised through Israel. Various ideas were current as to how this redemption of Israel was to be effected. Some thought it would be accomplished by natural means, through the ordinary course of historical development. Others thought that Israel would be miraculously transferred to a new land, marvelously fertile and transfigured. Still others thought that the restoration would be accompanied by the resurrection of the dead and the beginning of eternal rewards and punishments. The divine revelation of the Old Testament contained indications of the divinity of the Messiah. The teaching of the scribes not only ignored these prophecies, but progressively belittled his role and person. In their teaching, the Messiah was a mere man, whatever his gifts and office. His mission had nothing to do with supernatural benefits or the salvation of souls. His sole purpose, as far as they were concerned, was the delivery of Israel and the conquest of the Gentiles, who would then be forced to submit to the law, which the scribes regarded as their private property and their instrument of subjection. The Messiah had become, in popular imagination, a source of national glorification, a person through whom the Pharisaical conception of legalistic perfection would be imposed on all men. No consideration was given to the repeated prophecies concerning a suffering Messiah. Chapter 2. The Conflict. Even before Christ appeared on the banks of the Jordan to be baptized by John and to begin his public ministry, there were rumblings of the conflict that was to break out later into open hostility. Seeing the Pharisees and Sadducees coming to his baptism, Christ's precursor lashed out at them in public rebuke. "Ye brood of vipers," he cried, "who hath showed you to flee from the wrath to come?" Matthew chapter 3, verse 7. This public denunciation must have hurt deeply the pride of men accustomed to every public mark of respect. From that moment, John, and the one mightier than he, to whom he pointed, must have been the objects of suspicion and surveillance on the part of the political and religious leaders of the Jewish people. Throughout the public ministry of Christ, there was an undercurrent of opposition, an ominous surcharge of suspicion and hatred that broke out occasionally like the lightning that precedes the storm. The scribes and Pharisees were ever present, mingling with the crowd or hovering on its fringes, listening with cold hatred or suppressed fury to the teaching of this man who would lead the multitude away from them and their way of life. Long before the final Passover, they had made up their minds concerning Christ, and on many occasions they had sought to apprehend and kill him. Matthew chapter 12, verse 14, John chapter 7, verses 1, 20, and 30, chapter 10, verse 31, Luke chapter 13, verse 31. The opposition of the scribes and Pharisees derived from a variety of sources. One was undoubtedly professional jealousy. The scribes, who were for the most part learned Pharisees, formed a closed circle with their own schools, their own disciples, their own doctrines and teaching methods. They had built up a self-cult that almost passes belief. The scribes demanded complete reverence and obedience from their pupils. The pupil was to show greater respect for his teacher than for his own father. If a man's father and his teacher were both carrying burdens, the pupil must first help the teacher. If a man's father and his teacher were in captivity, the pupil must ransom the teacher first. Everything was taught and learned by rote. The disciple had to conform not only to the content of the teacher's doctrine, but even to his words and expressions. To the scribes, Christ was a rank outsider, an upstart. He had not studied in their schools. He did not use their methods. He did not teach their doctrines. Far from bolstering his teaching by quoting the famous rabbis of the past, he appealed only to his own authority and that of the Heavenly Father in whose name he spoke. How radical was this departure from custom is evidenced by the surprise of the people. The crowds were astonished at his teaching, for he was teaching them as one having authority, and not as their scribes and Pharisees. Matthew chapter 7, verse 29. Christ's teachings differed greatly from those of the scribes and Pharisees. Throughout his public ministry, there was constant friction on a variety of subjects. One of the most frequent causes of dispute, and one that most quickly and most certainly aroused the ire of the doctors learned in the law, was the question of Sabbath observance. Without going into great detail, the law of Moses simply forbade work on the Sabbath. This was not enough for the scribes, whose business it was to apply the law. By the time of Christ, they had refined a simple prohibition to a point where their teaching on that subject alone had become one of the widest of all fields of knowledge. Thus, Christ openly offended the Pharisees when he justified his disciples, who had plucked and eaten ears of grain on the Sabbath. Matthew chapter 12, verses 1 through 8. On this occasion, Christ went further and openly declared what must have sounded blasphemous to the startled Pharisees, "For the Son of Man is Lord even of the Sabbath." It seems strange to us that particularly violent objection was made to Christ's merciful healing on the Sabbath. After he had healed the man with a withered hand on the day of rest, the Pharisees went out and took counsel against him, how they might do away with him. Matthew chapter 12, verse 14. Christ met opposition and condemnation for the same reason when he cured the man born blind, John chapter 9, verse 1 and following, and healed an infirm woman, Luke chapter 13, verse 10 and following. The Israelites in general avoided all contact with the Gentiles. The Pharisees went further and avoided all contact with non-Pharisees because they considered them unclean and almost as low as the pagans. They were therefore angered and scandalized when Christ ate with publicans and sinners, Matthew chapter 9, verses 9 through 13, and when he ate without the ritual washing prescribed by the rabbinical tradition, Mark chapter 7, verses 1 through 23. Their national pride was cut deeply by Christ's clear references to the fact that Gentiles would be admitted to his kingdom and some Jews excluded, Luke chapter 13, verses 23 through 30. But above all, the scribes and Pharisees were aroused to fury against Christ by his patent assumption of divine prerogatives, as when he forgave sins, Luke chapter 5, verses 17 through 26, and particularly when, on the feast of the dedication that preceded the final Passover, he openly declared in Solomon's porch within the temple area, "I and the Father are one," John chapter 10, verse 30. So angered were Christ's adversaries that they took up stones to kill him. The story of the opposition to Christ on the part of the Sadducees is quite different from that of the scribes and Pharisees. Christ must have appeared to the Sadducees as a sort of eccentric, itinerant preacher, teaching a doctrine different from that accepted by the scribes and Pharisees, but of no interest or importance to the rich, influential, and agnostic clergy. As a result, the Sadducees appear rarely in the gospel narrative until the final fateful days in the life of Christ. The only time he cut squarely across their path was when he drove the merchants and money changers from the temple, for the profit from this desecration of the sacred area fell in large measure to the Sadducees. The event that precipitated final action against Jesus Christ was one of his greatest miracles and acts of mercy, the raising of Lazarus from the dead. After an absence of several months, Jesus appeared suddenly at Bethany, only 2 miles from Jerusalem, and, in view of a large assembly of mourners, called Lazarus forth from the tomb. Word of the miracle must have caused widespread public commotion. Jesus' enemies decided to put aside their differences and take action. They called a council of the rulers, at which Caiaphas, the high priest, presided. One of those present stated the case briefly. "If we let him alone as he is, all will believe in him, and the Romans will come and take away both our place and our nation." John chapter 11, verse 48. Wearied by the futile argument that followed, Caiaphas rose to his feet and declared, "You know nothing at all, nor do you reflect that it is expedient for us that one man die for the people instead of the whole nation perishing." John chapter 11, verse 50. That settled the matter. The assembly accepted Caiaphas' solution. St. John concludes, "So from that day forth, their plan was to put him to death." Chapter 11, verse 53. Jesus knew the plans of his enemies and retired from the Jerusalem area until the Saturday before the final Passover. On Sunday, Jesus entered Jerusalem in a triumphal procession as the crowds of pilgrims hailed him as the Messiah. When his enemies protested, Jesus said, "I tell you that if these keep silence, the stones will cry out." Luke chapter 19, verses 39 through 40. Early Monday morning, Jesus returned to Jerusalem and entered the temple area. He immediately proceeded to drive out those who were buying and selling. He overturned the tables of the money changers and the seats of those who sold doves. He stopped those who were making the sacred place an avenue of traffic as a shortcut from one part of the city to another, and then sternly rebuked those responsible for these desecrations of the holy place. "It is written," he said, "My house shall be called a house of prayer, but you have made it a den of thieves." Matthew chapter 21, verse 13. In the gospel passages that follow, there is a climax in the conflict between Jesus and the leaders of the Jewish people. Jesus fearlessly denounces his enemies while they employ every trick they can to catch him in his words so that they can denounce him to the people. Jesus narrates the parable of the two sons and applies the lesson to them in the biting words, "The publicans and harlots are entering the kingdom of God before you." Matthew chapter 21, verse 31. He concludes the long parable of the wicked husbandmen with the humiliating prophecy, "Therefore I say to you that the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and will be given to a people yielding its fruits." Matthew chapter 21, verse 43. Christ's patience has been exhausted, and his indignation is vented on these hard-hearted leaders of the people. His voice rings out through the silenced temple area and echoes back from the surrounding walls and porticos. "Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites! Because you shut the kingdom of heaven against men, woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites! Because you traverse sea and land to make one convert, and when he has become one, you make him twofold more a son of hell than yourselves. Woe to you, blind guides, you blind fools, blind ones!" Again and again comes the biting refrain as the discourse moves on and gains momentum. "Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, because you clean the outside of the cup and the dish, but within they are full of robbery and uncleanness. You are like whited sepulchres. You are full of hypocrisy and iniquity. Serpents, brood of vipers, how are you to escape the judgment of hell?" Matthew chapter 23, verse 13 and following. The evangelists do not inform us of the reaction of the scribes and Pharisees to this public castigation on the very spot where they thought their power and influence most secure. They must have been aghast. No mere words could answer the awful outburst of vituperation. They were cut too deeply in their pride to attempt further argument. They probably walked off in silence, deeply resolved to make Christ pay soon and fully for this open affront to their persons and office. If they spoke at all, it was probably to assure one another that they would call an immediate meeting to take proper steps to deal with this insufferable upstart. On Wednesday, Christ's enemies called another meeting. Chief priests, scribes, and ancients, representatives of the three groups that made up the Sanhedrin, Supreme Council of the Jews, met in the palace of Caiaphas. After much discussion, they again concluded that Christ must be put to death, but that nothing could be done on the approaching feast lest there be a riot among the people. They therefore decided to lay hands on Jesus secretly. Chapter 3. Judas Iscariot. It probably never entered the minds of Christ's enemies that they could find an ally among the 12 apostles, one of the little group most closely associated with him. And yet, it is one of the 12 who took the fateful and tragic step of going to these men to strike a bargain for the betrayal of Jesus Christ. Who was this man who could betray his friend and master for a sum? We know nothing about Judas except what is recorded in the Gospels and in the Acts of the Apostles. The legends concerning him in some of the apocryphal works are entirely without historical foundation, as are the purely fictitious interpretations of some moderns who would make a hero and patriot out of this son of perdition. John chapter 17, verse 12. Judas was a common and honorable name among the Jews. In fact, another apostle was also called Judas. When the evangelists refer to this latter, they take particular care lest they confuse him with Judas Iscariot, and they refer to him as Judas not the Iscariot, John chapter 14, verse 22, or as Jude the brother of James, Luke chapter 6, verse 16. The betrayer of Christ is referred to as Judas Iscariot, or as Judas who betrayed him, or occasionally as Judas one of the 12. This last expression seems to indicate the evangelist's feeling of horror that one so close to Christ could betray him. There is a variety of opinions concerning the meaning of the name Iscariot. The simplest and most probable is that it is derived from the Hebrew and means man of Kerioth. This would indicate that Judas, or at least his family, came from Kerioth Hezron in Judea. If this is true, then he was the only apostle who was not a Galilean. This fact would have more than academic interest, as it could explain a possible source of friction between Judas and the other apostles. The people of Judea looked down upon the Galileans. Galilee was at a distance from Jerusalem, the religious center of the nation, and was separated from it by the heretical and racially impure province of Samaria. It was regarded as infected by the pagan ideas of the surrounding peoples to such an extent that it was referred to as Galilee of the nations, Isaiah chapter 9, verse 1. There was a difference in dialect also between Galilee and Judea, as St. Peter's manner of speaking in the court of the high priest was to betray immediately his Galilean origin, Matthew chapter 26, verse 73. If Judas was from Judea and shared the Judean antipathy for Galileans, it must have been difficult for him to associate intimately with the other apostles. It is evident from their quarrels over precedence that they were not free from personal ambition. In Judas' case, the feeling of frustration at not obtaining preferment would have been increased by his sense of superiority over his fellow apostles. He may even have come to feel that the kingdom preached by Christ was essentially a Galilean movement, and as such, a rebellion of sorts against the supreme spiritual authority of Jerusalem. Judas Iscariot first enters the pages of history in the evangelist's account of Christ's selection of the 12 apostles. The gospel story indicates that, in Christ's mind, this event was one of very special import. Leaving behind him the crowds by the shores of the Sea of Galilee, Christ went up into a nearby hill and spent the night in prayer. As dawn broke the following morning, a crowd of disciples rejoined him. From among these disciples, Jesus selected 12 apostles, as he called them, that they might be with him and that he might send them forth to preach. To them he gave power to cure sicknesses and to cast out devils. Mark chapter 3, verses 14 through 15. It would be impossible to describe fully the honor and privilege conferred on Judas by the call to the apostolate. He was chosen to be one of the closest associates of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, in his redemptive work here on earth, and to be a cornerstone of the church he would establish to continue human redemption until the end of time. Judas, with the other apostles, was especially commissioned to preach the kingdom of God and to work miracles. Christ himself said to his chosen 12, "Amen, I say to you that you shall also sit on 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel." Matthew chapter 19, verse 28. So exalted was the dignity of the apostolate, so sacred the office, that one cannot help wondering whether Judas was evil at the time of his call or whether he fell from grace later. There can be no doubt that Jesus knew Judas' sentiments at the time and foresaw the ultimate fateful outcome. The Gospels throw no light on this subject, however, so we are left to draw our own conclusions from the circumstances. Whatever doubt there can be concerning Judas' sincerity in following Christ could be traceable to his ideas of the Messiah. It is highly probable that Judas, like the other apostles, originally followed Jesus because he believed him to be the Messiah. John chapter 1, verses 41 and 46. Undoubtedly, he and the other apostles shared the false ideas current at the time concerning the person of the Messiah and the kingdom he would inaugurate. The apostles, for example, until after the death and resurrection of Christ, found it difficult, if not impossible, to accept the idea of a suffering Messiah. Judas, then, may have attached himself to Christ in the belief that he was the Messiah and that it was only a matter of time before he would show himself in his role of king and conqueror. In this case, Judas must have become more and more disillusioned as time passed, for Christ not only failed to fulfill his expected role, but fled from honors and even talked of his approaching passion and death. About a year passes before Judas is again mentioned by an evangelist. Apparently, he has conformed in externals to the life of an immediate follower of Christ, or he would have occasioned comment. To his fellow apostles, he is still simply one of the 12. But Jesus makes a sudden and apparently unprovoked remark that, like a lightning flash in the night, illumines momentarily the depravity into which Judas has sunk. It was near the end of the first year of Christ's public ministry, and he was teaching at Capernaum on the northwest shore of the Sea of Galilee. Christ had spent so much of his time in this town that it was spoken of as his home. On this particular day, our Lord explained the doctrine of the Holy Eucharist. Christ's teaching was met at first with raised eyebrows and murmurs of incredulity. The Jews therefore murmured about him because he had said, "I am the bread that has come down from heaven." John chapter 6, verse 41. As Jesus continued his discourse, emphasizing his teaching, those present began to argue with one another, asking, "How can this man give us his flesh to eat?" Chapter 6, verse 53. Jesus not only did not withdraw his teaching, a cause of scandal to his listeners, but reiterated it and insisted on it. "Unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you shall not have life in you." Chapter 6, verse 54. As Jesus continued in the same vein, even his disciples began murmuring among themselves, saying, "This is a hard saying. Who can listen to it?" Chapter 6, verse 61. Jesus was well aware that many of his hearers would not pass this test of faith. As St. John writes, "Jesus knew from the beginning who they were who did not believe and who it was who should betray him." Chapter 6, verse 65. Jesus knew the unbelievers and the betrayer. Since the evangelist makes a distinction between unbelievers and the betrayer, it would not be logical to conclude from this passage that Judas had already lost or was losing his faith. Nothing is said of his faith in the text. It is evident from St. John's account that Jesus has reached a moment of crisis in his public ministry. Since the beginning of his preaching, he had spent most of his time in and near Capernaum, and probably most of his disciples were from this area. By this time, they should have had sufficient faith in Jesus to believe him for his own sake, even if they could not understand his teaching or accept it without difficulty. Yet, when Jesus announced the doctrine of the Holy Eucharist, many of his disciples murmured and argued among themselves, and they finally came to the conclusion that this teaching was too hard for them. St. John says, "From this time, many of his disciples turned back and no longer went about with him." Chapter 6, verse 67. The first part of Christ's ministry had apparently ended in almost complete failure. St. John then relates Christ's question to the 12. If this question followed immediately on the departure of the disciples, it would seem that all of them deserted Christ and only the apostles remained. It may be, however, that there was at least a little interval of time between the two events, and that Christ waited to put his question to the 12 when he was alone with them. There is something tragic in this incident. Jesus must have watched sadly as he saw his disciples turn their backs on him and go their way, probably still discussing in small and animated groups the impossibility and even absurdity of his teaching. An atmosphere of frustration and discouragement must have surrounded those who remained. We can imagine Christ watching for a few pensive moments before he turned to the silent group of apostles still with him and asked, "Do you also wish to go away?" There was a moment of silence, a moment in which each apostle searched his heart for his reply. The first to find and formulate his answer was St. Peter, and he spoke in words that have come ringing down the ages, "Lord, to whom shall we go? Thou hast the words of everlasting life, and we have come to believe and to know that Thou art the Christ, the Son of God." John chapter 6, verse 70. In his simplicity and forthrightness, Peter thought he spoke for himself and all the others. Jesus calls attention to his mistake in words that must have been a shock to the little group. "Have I not chosen you, the 12, yet one of you is a devil?" John chapter 6, verse 71. They had not become apostles by their own choice. They had not merited this singular grace and honor. But Christ himself had chosen them as members of a special group, the 12. In spite of this, one of them is a devil. Christ's emphasis on the fact that he himself had chosen them casts into greater relief the ingratitude and malice of the one who is a devil. The term devil, as Christ uses it here, does not indicate diabolical possession. It means simply that the one referred to was doing the work of a devil, was like a devil, or was as evil as a devil. Jesus does not foretell the betrayal, nor does he identify the one to whom he refers. His words were a warning, a grace proffered secretly to one who has already gone far on the road to destruction. St. John, in the light of later events, tells us that Christ referred to Judas Iscariot, who was to betray him. We have no record of the reaction of Judas or the other apostles to Christ's words, but the course of subsequent events reveals that Judas did not heed Christ's warning. We do not know whether he or the others made a protestation similar to Peter's. It is probable that St. Peter's answer was accepted as the reply of all. Judas, by his silence, associated himself hypocritically with St. Peter's declaration of faith. His whole existence until his tragic death had now become a living lie. For over a year, a veil of silence descends upon Judas in the gospel narrative. He does not reappear until the supper at Bethany on the Saturday evening before the death of Christ. During this time, although he was a devil, as Christ called him, he must have continued to live the life of an apostle in all externals. Up to the very end, his companions had no suspicion of the evil locked in his heart. At Bethany, it is again St. John who casts a clear light upon Judas and reveals an ugly facet of his character. At a supper in the home of Simon the leper, Mary Magdalene poured an extremely precious ointment over the head and feet of Jesus and wiped his feet with her hair. As so often in this life, vice comes quickly face to face with virtue and niggardliness with generosity. Those present began to realize, and then to discuss, the great value of the ointment that Mary had used. They estimated that it was worth more than 300 denarii, a laborer's pay for a year, more than enough, according to St. Philip's estimate, to supply food for 5,000 men. Refer to John chapter 6, verse 7. Such extraordinary prodigality they found shocking, and they did not hesitate to express their indignation to one another. Some of Christ's followers, probably the apostles, joined in the remonstrances. Judas seems to have protested the loudest, as St. John, who was present, mentions him by name. Judas Iscariot, he who was about to betray him, said, "Why was this ointment not sold for 300 denarii and given to the poor?" Now he said this not that he cared for the poor, but because he was a thief, and, holding the purse, used to take what was put in it. Chapter 12, verses 4 through 6. The other disciples were undoubtedly sincere, but St. John, with inspired knowledge, looked into the heart of Judas and revealed the hypocrisy in his pretended interest in the poor. St. John thus clearly tells us that Judas was a thief who stole money that had been committed to his care. We have certainty from the words of St. John that Judas had been abusing the confidence Christ and the apostles placed in him by stealing from the common purse. There, etched by the pen of an inspired evangelist, we have the portrait of a thief, a hypocrite, and an avaricious man, one who is on the verge of plunging into the depths of evil. The events of the first 2 days of Holy Week could leave no doubt in Judas' mind that the day of final settlement between Jesus and his enemies was fast approaching, when he and the other apostles would have to stand and be counted, would have to declare themselves for Jesus or against him, for the leaders of the Jews or against them. Judas decided, and his decision was one of monstrous perfidy. He would go over to the enemy, and in so doing would betray his master into their hands for whatever price he could get from them. He would, by one act, free himself from the suspicion and danger now surrounding an apostle of Jesus Christ. He would win favor with the chief priests and Pharisees by executing their order to report Jesus' whereabouts, John chapter 11, verse 56, and he would line his own pockets. Judas left Jesus and the apostles, probably at Bethany, and headed for Jerusalem. He mounted the western hill of the city toward the spot where tradition places the palace of the high priest. Once he had given some inkling of the purpose of his visit, he had no difficulty in gaining admission. It is likely that he was interviewed by some of the chief priests, those whose duty it would be to make the decisions and act in the matter. Also present were officers of the temple police. It would be their duty to take the necessary steps to arrest Jesus under the guidance of Judas. As a matter of fact, we find them present later at the arrest of Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane. Luke chapter 22, verse 52. Judas went straight to his point, brutally and frankly. There were no evasions about losing faith in the Master, no protestations about fulfilling his duty as a true Israelite. "What are you willing to give me, and I will deliver him to you?" Matthew chapter 26, verse 15. How much haggling there was over the payment, we do not know. The evangelists tell us only that Judas and the chief priests reached an agreement on the sum to be paid. St. Matthew alone specifies that it was for 30 pieces of silver. This coin was worth 4 denarii. The 30 pieces of silver would therefore equal 120 denarii. And since the denarius was a day's pay for a soldier or laborer, the amount of money promised Judas was the equivalent of a laborer's pay for 120 days of work. St. Matthew probably mentions the exact amount because he recalled the fact that the law decreed 30 pieces of silver as the compensation for a slave killed by an ox. Exodus chapter 21, verse 32. Refer also to Zechariah chapter 11, verse 12. Judas agreed to the offer and from that moment determined to put into execution his part of the bargain. With the insufficient data given us by the Gospels, it is difficult to analyze the character and motives of Judas Iscariot. He is, and will remain to the end of time, a mystery of evil. It is frightening to compare the pinnacle of greatness to which he was called with the abyss of wickedness to which he plunged. What could have led him to such depths of evil? As we have heard, Judas was a thief as well as an opportunist who joined Christ because he believed that he was the Messiah and that, as one of his earliest followers, he would ensure himself an important place in his kingdom. On the one hand, Judas must have been deeply impressed by Christ's miracles, but on the other hand, repelled by his refusal to accept honors, by his teaching of humility, charity and self-sacrifice, by his poverty and complete indifference to worldly goods and comforts, his revelation of a messianic kingdom completely devoid of all that Judas imagined it should be, and above all, his adoption of the role of a suffering and dying.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.